Welcome to the Stage. Evelien IJzendijk and Margot Roosendaal.
Well, thank you for being here, and thank you, Hilke, for having us here to tell you something more about the usage of data within DPG Media. And before we go into details, I want to ask you, please take your mobile phone and go to www.menti.com and go to menti.com and enter the code 562361. And I wanted to know, what is DPG Media? Do you know? What does it mean to you? I'm just curious. And I think, yeah, you can enter three answers. So if you have more thoughts about it than just one, let us know. Ads as the first one. That's true.
I have no idea.
No idea. Yeah, I can imagine, because there are probably a lot of English-speaking people here, but I also heard some Flemish around, so I expect other answers than the Dutch ones. Let's see. Publisher, that's right. Media, newspapers. Recruitment. That's right. And it was formerly known as the Persgroep Media. We've recently changed names, so we're now DPG Media. And it's very funny, because I asked this question, I've asked it before, and people usually come up with a couple of our brands, but it doesn't happen right now, so I'm wondering why. Medialaan, which is indeed Flemish part, focusing on television. Well, we have a lot of answers already. I'm glad that no one entered De Telegraaf, which is one of the popular newspapers in the Netherlands, and it's not part of DPG Media. We have another one, it's AD. I'm going to switch to the presentation again, because we have a lot of answers. This is actually what it is. So DPG Media is a Belgian media company with Dutch department also. And here I have all the Dutch brands on screen. We publish 11 national and regional newspapers, and we also own various online platforms, which we call our online services, giving consumers practical information on getting a job, buying a new car, on which insurance you should take. And today we're going to focus on our news media part, so on our B2C industry, with which we reach 1.3 million people a day, because these are our subscribers. And as a lot of publishing companies, we have seen a decline in print in the recent years in favor of reading, having consumers read our news more and more on our websites. And this is reflected in the number you can see on screen. We have a 70% increase in digital subscriptions in 2019 with respect to 2018. And these subscribers visit our websites, we hope, every day or even more times a day. But not only subscribers visit our website, because a large part of our content is available for free, we also have non-subscribers reading our news daily. And together, we welcome about 5.5 million unique browsers a day. And this makes us the first media company with respect to news reach in the Netherlands. And all these people together read about 600 million articles a month. And you can imagine this generates a huge amount of data. I wrote down in the presentations 150 gigabytes a day. But I think this is a number from September, so I think it must be more right now, because it really grows rapidly, especially with respect to video data, which is also included in this number. This gives you an impression of the platforms on which we gather this 150 or even more gigabyte of data. Most of our browsers visit our platforms via their mobile phones, so mobile web. But we also gather data from our apps and our special tablet apps, the edition. And we use this data in our company for a wide variety of purposes. For example, we build a segmentation with which we segment our consumers with respect to their reading behavior. So we have the sports segment, we have the news of the day segment, we have the culture lovers, and we use this segmentation to give insights to our marketers, but also to our journalists, and we use it to personalize communication. We also use people's click behavior to inform our journalists in the newsroom, for example, of course, on which article did well, but also whether a certain headline was a good one or whether they should use another one via IB testing. And today we want to share with you a use case from our marketing department, because this is where the data is also used heavily. And what we wanted to do was we wanted to predict online conversion. So we wanted to predict people's propensity to pay for a subscription by means of their reading behavior. So we used the amount of articles they read, what they read, how often they read, how often they visited our platforms to predict their willingness to go to our conversion website, krant.nl, which is newspaper.nl, and take a subscription there. Of course, the underlying goal was to target people more specifically at the moment they were ready to convert instead of spamming them with banners all the time. And they're not ready for that. This gives you a schematic overview of all the data we used to solve this use case, because it was not only the online data. On the bottom, you can find the click data, which we gather by means of our first-party clickstream Snowplow. This data is transferred to S3 and also cleaned there, and it gives us information on the platform, the time that the browser comes to our platforms, what they read, where they came from, etc. We have a lot of anonymous users, of which we only have the clicking behavior, but we also have a lot of people who log in and who are known to us. And this, the data of these people is stored on Redshift. It's the CRM data, for example, whether they already have a subscription or had one in the past, whether they have a trial subscription now, which is in our lead system. And we also buy some external data on the household level. This is all stored on Redshift, and therefore we have a small subset of our clickstream also transferred to Redshift, where we can combine the two. And we use Data IQ for data preparation, also model building, and Looker for dashboarding. And now I'm going to hand over to Evelien, because she is going to tell you more about the technical details on building the model.
Okay, before I'm going to tell you something about the conversion model we created, I would like you all to go to menti.com and add the following code. Oh, that's quite quick. please, if you could tell me, what kind of algorithm do you use mostly in your daily job? So you see a lot of classification, a lot of regression. So we're almost 90. Okay, I'm going to go back to the presentation.
We have a winner.
Now. Yes, we have a winner, the classification. Yes. So in our case, we want to predict the conversions versus the non-conversions, which is also a classification problem. And to do that, we want to use the online behavior as well as the CRM data to predict conversion. We use Data IQ for the data pre-processing part as well as the model building part. Well, to start with the data pre-processing, some of the variables we use to predict are the number of page views a cookie has seen, the number of articles that are read, how much time does a cookie spend online, and what is their mean session duration, for example, but also the paygate encounters. And it's good to know that not our articles are freely accessible at our website. So, for example, you can read 7 articles for free, and after that, you hit a pay gate. So all these pay gate encounters are also taken into the model. And then we've got some CRM data. For example, do we recognize this cookie as someone who has a subscription to one of our newsletters? And do we recognize this cookie as someone who has had an earlier subscription? There are some challenges with this input data, since there are so much data from our clickstream that it's really necessary to optimize your code in every possible way. So think about no unnecessary joins, think about the schemas of your tables, minimize your data as much as possible to reduce your runtime. Another problem we encountered is that we have a highly unbalanced input set, since there are a lot of non-conversions and only a really small set of conversions. So what we did was take all conversions and add a random set of non-conversions, but you have to keep in mind to rescale your scores afterwards. So for the model part, we tried different models, but eventually we ended up with a random forest. It's actually a good trade-off between, on the one hand, explainability for the business, and on the other hand, a robust and unlikely to overfit model. We use the MLlib option in DataIQ instead of the in-memory model building, because this gives you the opportunity to score large sets of data in a relatively short amount of time. Then the variable importance. So at number three, we've got, oh, sorry.
Oh, you can see it.
The number of articles someone has read. At two, we've got the PayGate views. And at one, we've got previous visits at Kramp.nl, which is the subscription website. So, which is obviously a good indicator that someone's interested in buying a subscription. So how do we use this model? We score this model every day, and this results in different conversion probabilities. And we divide these probabilities into 10 different buckets, where bucket number one contains the cookies with the highest probability of conversion, and bucket number 10 contains the cookies with the lowest number of conversions. Well, we believe that these cookies in the top buckets are ready for conversion. So these buckets get to see a banner with a subscription offer. So whenever we recognize these people online, they will see a banner with a subscription offer, for example, this one. If we compare that with the lower buckets, so we think these people aren't quite ready yet for their conversion, so these people need to become more engaged with our products. So these people will be shown a banner with an article that might be interesting to them. Because when these people will read more articles, they become more engaged, and hopefully their conversion probability will go up. So this model has only been live for about 2 months, so we haven't got much of results yet, but these are the first results we've got. We've got a random group, which is the green line, and this random group is randomly taken out of all the 10 different buckets, and these people were shown a subscription banner as well. And also in bucket one and bucket two, people have seen the subscription banner. And we see that the lines are a bit messed up, I'm sorry, that bucket one is performing 15 times better than the random group, and our bucket two is performing 4 times better than our random group. And this gives us an indication that our model is actually quite capable of picking out the correct cookies that are ready for conversions. However, we do not know yet the added value of these banners, so that's something we're testing right now. Then, some key takeaways already. So we've got a large amount of data, so you really need to optimize your code in every possible way. We faced some troubles with our unbalanced target. And last but certainly not least, testing. So test your model, test your banners, but also test the boundaries of the different buckets, so test everything. So thank you very much for your attention.
Okay. No, thank you.